I'm so excited because I'm such a huge fan of our next guest. He's an award-winning poet, a former BuzzFeed News co-host, master of the Twitterverse, and the writer of a stunning new memoir.
In How We Fight for Our Lives, he shares his heart-wrenching, eye-opening, and hopeful story of growing up Black and gay in Texas. Please welcome author Saeed Jones.
Hi!
To meet you.
I'm so excited.
I almost tripped down the stairs.
It's true.
I love this book. You write about your experience. This is a memoir. And yet the title of the book is How We Fight for Our Lives. So why the use of we as opposed to I?
I wanted to make it clear from the very beginning that this is not going to be an identity or trauma vacation. You know, I went through a lot. You know, growing up in Texas, single mother, Black and gay. I mean, yes, it's fraught. My story is somewhat harrowing. But I didn't want readers to go, ooh, that's so interesting. And then just go back to their lives. I wanted everything you read about my life to be in conversation with your life, whether you see parallels or differences. We are all fighting for our lives. We all are, you know? Like, it was a struggle for me to grow up as a Black gay kid. It was a struggle for my mom to raise me, you know, as a single parent. So I wanted to honor the fact that we're all trying to figure this life thing out together.
Yeah, I love that. We're in this together. We are. And you also single out two events in the book that marked you significantly growing up. Yeah. First, the murder of James Byrd Jr., a Black man who was killed by three white supremacists. And then also the death of Matthew Shepard, a 21-year-old gay student who was killed in 1998. So you wrote, being Black can get you killed. Being gay can get you killed. Being a Black gay boy is a death wish. So how did you wrestle yourself away from the fatalism that seemed to really surround you growing up?
It took a long time. It took a long time because for so long, I mean, yeah, it was like if a Black queer person appeared in the media, it was connected to HIV/AIDS, just violence, just tragedy, you know? But I think, you know, for me, reading has always been how I understand my place in the world and beginning to find mentors who are like living, vibrant, wonderful writers, meeting, you know, people out who are out here doing the work, joyful and insightful, you know? I think it can get easy to be cynical about representation. It can, but it matters seeing Billy Porter work the red carpet. That matters.
Oh my gosh.
You know, and
yes.
I know there are kids at home who go, oh, I can do that too. You know, so I think that was, you know, it was reading, but also just, you know, thank goodness a lot of progress has been made. We have a lot of work to do still, right? But things are somewhat different. I mean, we have drag queens on morning shows. We, you know what I mean? You know, Pose is wonderful and introducing Black trans women to the public conversation. Laverne Cox, Janet Mock, you know, that visibility. Sam Smith.
Saeed Jones.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, seeing that, you know, I think it gives us hope. And it also lets us know that we don't have to speak for everyone. You know what I mean? I love that I can disagree with Ellen on live TV. You know what I mean? Because I know that people aren't going to go, well, Ellen speaks for all gay people or Saeed speaks for all gay people. So that range of experience, I think just it frees us. You know what I mean? And we feel that in terms of gender, just seeing women of different perspectives, like here on the show, right? Like that's really powerful, seeing that like, oh, there are so many different ways to live joyfully.
Let's talk about your growing up with your mom, single mom. The book is dedicated to her. And you tell of coming out to her when you were in college. And it was not exactly the most dramatic conversation. But afterwards, you write that you, quote, went back to erasing myself. Can you explain what that was?
Sure, and it's been interesting because since the book has come out, I mean, this is the end of a 19-stop book tour I've been doing, and so many people have identified with that part of the book, where I come out to my mom my freshman year of college. We have a fairly positive, good kind of coming out moment. And then for the next 2 years, basically, anytime I tried to basically work up the energy to talk about boys, you know, boyfriends, like men are trash, mom, you know, being gay is not a choice because if I had my options, I would not be dating these trash bags, but here we are. Here we are, you know, and so I would try to like get advice just as a like, how do we work this out, you know? And my mom, I describe it as like, if you know someone who's afraid of heights, It felt like leading them to the edge of a bridge. You know, someone you love and you can feel them pulling back. And I would look at her when I would try to talk about being gay and I would see fear and hurt. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes we shut ourselves down. Mm. We go, you know what, I love you so much, I'm not gonna talk about it. Mm. You know what I mean? I mean, this is November.
Yeah, I'm gonna make myself less than to make you okay.
And that's not just a gay thing. Listen, Thanksgiving's coming up, and at least in the United States, the holidays are coming up. We do this in a lot of ways with our loved ones. We go, ooh, I'm not gonna talk about it, either because we're afraid that it's too difficult or we perceive that, you know, and that is a kind of violence.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Shutting yourself down, even if you're doing it as an act of love, that comes at a cost. And so you see that in the book, like that silence, that shutting, that energy, that goes somewhere, you know? And for me, I was really suffering because of it.
You also talk a lot about masculinity in the book. Mm-hmm. You really hold up a mirror to the men around you. I mean, some are caring, some are violent. Yeah. So specifically an incident with a man you called Daniel.
Yeah.
So what happened and what was the conversation that you really wanted to start and by sharing that?
And that incident was the inspiration for the book. It started with an essay. My senior year of college, I go to a New Year's Eve party. And this is going into 2008, so this is, you know, January. And I meet a guy at a party, a straight guy, so handsome. And we end up going back to his place. And, you know, I think he was closeted or somewhere on the spectrum of not feeling like he could be his full self. And, you know, when you're like that, like I said, that energy, when we were alone, it like exploded. Like he was so passionate and aggressive. And I was like, whoa, calm down. Oh my gosh, you know. And then it very quickly became violent. You know, and I think that that's not a coincidence, you know, that the eagerness was also like this violent explosion. And so we ended up, you know, we were both very, very drunk and intoxicated. Again, I think a lot of people, you know, when they're holding things down, they wait until they are, you know, intoxicated to feel more comfortable. And yeah, we both ended up fighting for our lives. He was sobbing. And it wasn't like a bully, like, haha, I'm gonna get you. He was crying as he's beating me up, you know? And he just kept saying, I'm so evil, I'm so evil. And I was like, no, you're not. You know what I mean? And so I think just realizing that this man who was about to do something permanently destructive was suffering was a wake-up call for me. And so I just think there are a lot of people like that in not just America, but everywhere. And I just think that a man who has not figured out masculinity, who has not figured out gender, is like a man driving down the highway in a big truck going 75 miles per hour, swerving. Mm-hmm. He's a danger to himself and all of us too, right?
Yeah.
Those
are...
Thank you.
These are the kinds of stories that you share in your book to really illuminate what your experience has been. But as you say, joy is also important.
Yeah.
And you are so joyful, yes. Looking at your face. And that is also one
Saeed
of the purposes.
Saeed means happy.
Yes. And you are also known for your work as an award-winning poet and a writer, an author. Mm-hmm. But also people know you from Twitter. That's how I first met you.
I love it.
You are on Twitter as The Ferocity.
Yes.
So I would like to know, given that you think joy is also important, mm-hmm. why you've decided to call yourself The Ferocity on social media too and present yourself that way.
Because glitter can cut. You know, I noticed that like often words like yes, queen and fierce and work, you know, these words are kind of taken away from gay or queer people and they lose their strength. And I was like, fierce is actually a really feral, that is a powerful element, you know? And so I wanted to draw attention to the strength that I see, you know, just because I'm femme and I got a fabulous manicure, and I do, you know, doesn't mean I won't read the house down. Doesn't mean I'm not willing to talk to you about national or international politics. Doesn't mean I'm not willing to talk to you about Audre and Ridge or Gertrude Stein. We can do it all, mm-hmm. you know. But for so long, particularly black queer men in media, you know, we've been kind of relegated to being the best friend who dispenses advice, but we don't have that complexity. So The Ferocity is about trying to bring all of that together.
It has been such a joy to meet you, Saeed. Thank you so much for being here today. The book is called How We Fight for Our Lives. I love this book. And members of our studio audience, you are all going home with a copy today. We'll be right back.